Good morning, everyone, and welcome to worship here this morning. We're happy to have you here with us, worshiping virtually from wherever you are welcome here. It's the second day of spring. The sun is shining. Hopefully it's shining where you are, and it looks to be a lovely day here in southeastern Michigan. I hope you get a chance to get outside today and enjoy this beautiful weather that we're going to be having. A few announcements that we have for you before we enter into the spirit of worship. One link is all you need for worship from here on out. That link is located in your Salem happenings, and it's also been embedded in the Salem UCC webpage too. We are recording every service and of course uploading these to social media and then again to our YouTube account as well. So if you can find that, please pass those things on, share the message of God through Salem UCC and help spread the good news. Lenten Confession and Communion check-in is this Wednesday and next Wednesday. We've got two more of these left. We will be having some time to check in with one another and share in communion. And our food drive is a week later than normal. Usually it's the first Friday of the month. It's the second Friday of this coming month, April 9th. Rick, I got these times right? From 6 to 7 p.m. in the church parking lot? Yes, that is correct. So just take note of that and help us give food. I'll be saying a little bit more about that during the reflection today. Worship Nights is this Wednesday on Instagram too. If you're a fan of Worship Nights, join in on Instagram at 6:30 p.m. and share in the Word of God through our church members that share it there. After worship today too, our leadership team is going to meet in another Zoom room. And one of the things that we're going to be approaching is a roadmap to re-entry. How are we going to come back to worship in person? I just received my first vaccination this past Thursday. It's the Moderna vaccination. So I have to go back on April 15th for my second round of vaccinations. And then 2 weeks after that, I'm kind of declared, I guess, okay to go out. But we still need a roadmap for all of us as we come back together or consider to come back together inside the sanctuary. So we're going to be discussing those things, and I want you to keep your eyes peeled for information and news as your leadership team works diligently to come up with a solid plan for all of us to keep us all safe. In the name of Jesus Christ, no matter where you are on life's journey, you are welcome here. Let's take some time to center ourselves in the Spirit of God. to invite our liturgist and our responsive reader to unmute as we open with our call to worship.
The days are surely coming, says our God. The day is here to affirm a new covenant.
We call on God's steadfast love and mercy. We seek a strong and vital relationship with our God.
God's law will be written on our hearts. Our Creator claims us and forgives us our faithlessness.
We are eager to know the God who lives in us. We are ready to learn God's intentions for us.
God offers us the joy of salvation. Our brokenness can be healed and wholeness restored.
We are open to the new and right spirit God offers. We seek guidance for our daily living.
As Jesus offered up prayers and supplication to you, O God, we cry out to you today. You know our losses and our fears. You understand our suffering and pain. We wish to see Jesus, to know the healing touch felt by so many. We want to hear a reassuring voice. We long to see a new day when evil is overcome and wrong cannot prevail. Lift us up and draw us to yourself as we worship in this hour. Equip us for our daily living as we seek to be true to your covenant with us. Amen.
Beloved, the doubts and inattention that mark our response to God summons us now to confess our sin. The promises of God, which we have ignored, draw us back to consider the covenant God offers. The obedience of Jesus can inspire in us a reverent submission to God's will. Let us seek forgiveness and reconciliation. Let us lift our sins to God in silence. Would you pray with me our prayer of confession? Have mercy on us, O God, according to your steadfast love. Wash us thoroughly from our iniquity and cleanse us from our sin. We know more of our own transgression than we have been willing to admit even to ourselves. We cannot escape from the sin that clings so closely. By our actions and our neglect, we have done what is evil in your sight. May your judgment help us to face the truth about ourselves, then wash away the stain of our iniquity. Create in us clean hearts and renew our spirits. We are ready for a new life. Hear these words of forgiveness, beloved. We are welcomed into God's redeeming presence. We are children of our Creator who loves us. We are brothers and sisters of Jesus, who is obedient to God and faithful to the law of love, even in the face of the cross. Through suffering, Christ became the source of eternal salvation for us, realized when we embrace the covenant in truth and faithfulness. The burden of our sin is lifted from us. New life is and has always been and forever will be ours to enjoy. We are forgiven. Amen.
Our Old Testament reading today comes from the book of Jeremiah, chapter 31, verses 31 through 34. The days are surely coming, says the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah. It will not be like the covenant that I made with their ancestors when I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt, a covenant that they broke, though I was their husband, says the Lord. But this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, says the Lord. I will put my law within them, and I will write it on their hearts. And I will be their God, and they shall be my people. No longer shall they teach one another or say to each other, "Know the Lord," for they shall all know me, from the least of them to the greatest, says the Lord. For I will forgive their iniquity and remember their sin no more.
Shalom, my friends. Shalom, my friends. Shalom, shalom. God's peace be with you. God's peace be with you. Shalom, shalom. Share peace, dear friends. Share peace. Till we
and love it when things come together. Shalom is a perfect way to begin our reflection this morning. According to the JPS Hebrew commentary, the word shalom doesn't just mean peace. It's a part of it, yes. But the full meaning is the absence of lack. Think about that for a moment. Shalom is the absence of lack. Shalom is not needing, not wanting, not straining. Your cup is filled and overflows. Our reflection reading this morning comes from Psalm 119, verses 9 through 16. How can young people keep their way pure? By guarding it according to your word. With my whole heart I seek you. Do not let me stray from your commandments. I treasure your word in my heart, so that I may not sin against you. Blessed are you, O Lord. Teach me your statutes. With my lips I declare all the ordinances of your mouth. I delight in the way of your decrees as much as in all riches. I will meditate on your precepts and fix my eyes on your ways. I will delight in your statutes. I will not forget your word. Would you pray with me? O holy and loving Lord God, breathe into us your spirit, we pray. The words from my mouth and the meditations of my heart may be wholly acceptable to you, and to find a home in the hearts of these, your beloved. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen. There's a part of me that's going to enjoy being far away from y'all this morning, because I'm going to talk about stewardship. And that just means that whatever rotten tomatoes you might hold in your hands can't reach me from where you are. There is no seminary class called Stewardship 101. In fact, seminary lacks many practical courses that would be quite helpful to the beginning minister. The thing is, however, with so many different nuanced traditions and practices, any practical ministry leadership course would be weighed down with the tiny specifics, so many that the overall practical idea being taught would probably get lost in the shuffle. Stewardship is one of hundreds of practical ministry ideas I wish seminary could have covered. I recall talking about stewardship, albeit briefly, but the conversations around it were more vague than specific, unless, of course, the seminary was talking about making a donation after graduation to the seminary. They were quite specific about that. The seminary was and has been pointed in that conversation. They mail me frequently, about four times a year, and clearly spell out how the money I donate will be used. In my time at the churches I've served, however, I haven't once been a part of a leadership team that wasn't, at the very least, slightly concerned about their finances. Confession time. For me personally, finances, my personal finances, are a source of toxic stress. Now, I would love to live comfortably, where I didn't have to worry about where the money was coming from in the next couple of weeks to pay, for example, my outrageous car insurance bill that I just received, on top of these love notes from the Secretary of State's office that tells me my car and both of my RVs, the tabs are due. Happy birthday, Greg. It's all coming. Oh, the stress. And then I hear somebody sing Shalom, and I long for the absence of lack. Like I mentioned, I would love to live comfortably to the point where I didn't have to worry about where the money was coming from. Even at the same time, I got another love note from Consumers Energy. You see, when I signed up to pay the gas bill here, I signed up for paperless, and I was supposed to get an email on a regular basis. Well, twice since I've lived here in the last 8 months, I've received these notes that say, hey, guess what, Greg? In a month, if you don't pay this outrageous gas bill, we're gonna shut off your gas. Because you see, the emails haven't shown up. So I spent a couple hours on the phone with customer service on Friday, and they still haven't figured out whatever glitches in their system to where I can't get their emails. But the second I do get one of those letter formats in the mail saying a shutoff is coming, my heart stops. It adds to that stress. Money, for many in my generation, Generation Xers, has been and remains a concern. An alarming number of us aren't able to live like our parents or our grandparents did because the economy today isn't working in our favor. Here's something that points to this. Last year, just as we started our pandemic isolation, I received an email from Rochester Area Neighborhood House. There are several neighborhood houses that help out their communities. The Rochester Area Neighborhood House sent out a message stating that their base, the people that they serve, their service area, that more than 25% of families in their service area were one paycheck away from needing the first line of poverty defense, a food pantry. More than 25% of families in the Rochester area. Does that compute to you? Because it doesn't to me. We live in Oakland County, the wealthiest county in the state of Michigan. But here in just the Rochester service area for Rochester Area Neighborhood House, more than 25% of families live one paycheck away from needing poverty relief. Poverty prevention. I'm part of that percentage. You see, my overhead is too high, and I understand that. My income to support that overhead is too low to be really comfortable to live in that idea of shalom. Now, I make ends meet, but the toxic stress is still there. And I have the waistline to prove it. You see, I tend to eat my toxic stress in bowls of ice cream. 2 weeks ago, for example, I had a stress test. And in that stress test, my doctor said, you know what? Your heart is fine. But it took an alarmingly low amount of time for my heart to reach its target heart rate of 144 beats per minute to measure its health. In other words, I am way out of shape for a guy my age. I need to work on that. Why do I tell you this? Well, you see, the church can experience this too. The church, think of the church as a life form together, okay? Just wrap your mind around that idea for a minute. Money and all things that concern money brings a certain toxic stress to the life of the church. And when I say church, in its kind of a human form, I'm talking about the capital C church, not the lowercase c church as in place building, but the capital C, the community that resides there together. That's the capital C church, the people. And the church thinks about things like taking care of the lowercase c, the church building, and its budget. Like being an older human being, there are more structural health concerns to some buildings, are there not? And without the appropriate means of taking care of those concerns, they can come back to haunt you in building medical expenses, or what we call deferred maintenance. And that's the last thing I need for my own human body is deferred maintenance. I already have some to work on. In the sense of a building, those things that the church leadership would say, we don't have money now to take care of it, we'll do that later. Well, those things pile up and grow and grow. And at the same time, the trajectory of mainline denominational church membership is growing less and less. And of course, when you add all that up, with less membership support, less can be done or afforded to be done. Churches with massive endowments can cruise along, of course, living much off the interest earned, while those communities without an endowment paddle their faithful boat with all of their membership hands in the water, and a few people holding buckets trying to bail out the boat. It doesn't seem fair, does it? Yet that's the reality in which we live. The reality that many people, more people than we care to acknowledge, live in today. Preaching fiduciary responsibility to church membership is often like resting a loaded shotgun on one's foot. One wrong word, statement, anything, and the pastor is going to lose a foot. Walking away from the pulpit limping, or sometimes crawling. It's been our pastoral discomfort about money and its connection to our faith that has led many preachers to simply avoid the conversation of fiduciary responsibility altogether, mainly because church members will tell their pastors, we don't want to hear another conversation on money to the church. Knock it off. That brings us to our scripture readings for today. My favorite prophet of the exile, Jeremiah, and Psalm 119. These two readings pack a powerful punch in our understanding of what it means to be in covenant. As you heard Andrew speak, Jeremiah speaks to the law that is written on their hearts. They had the written one in stone, but you see, people can disobey that one. But if it's written on your hearts, it's something different. And the psalmist echoes that sentiment too, speaks to the law being taught and treasured in one's heart, not on a stone tablet or written on a list of what not to do's, but an idea that is lived into, because we are in covenant. I think one of the greatest things that I appreciated about the United Church of Christ is something that we find in the preamble of our denomination's constitution and bylaws. It talks specifically about covenantal relationship, about how it's really written on our hearts, our responsibilities to the commitment that we make to our community, to our capital C church, which is taking care of the lower case C church too. It's a covenant commitment, we say. And each of us at one time or another, whether we've been confirmed in our faith at the church that we grew up in, or whether we joined a new church and we affirmed our faith, we spoke words of covenant commitment. We spoke words of how we are going to together take care of one another. And the church, the capital C, has unintentionally moved away from that model because we don't like to talk about money. And we don't like to talk about politics either, frankly. And all of those things are inextricably woven with the gospel message of Jesus Christ. Whether we want to hear it or not, that's where it is. You can't separate them. Growing concerns over money and the intentionality of ministry away from the Spirit in Christ, we point our attention towards the ledger instead, where we're more concerned about the red we see at the bottom of a budget than we are about the red-lettered words of Jesus Christ in our Bibles. I remember listening to Trinity UCC pastor Otis Moss III speak at a conference I was at in Chicago. And he said something like this: if your ministry mindset is money, Christ loses to commerce. Was profound. And that sentiment has stuck with me ever since. I understand, even in my own upbringing in church, that when I was a youth, I don't recall really hearing that much about our church's finances. And maybe that was part of that same generational idea. We don't like to talk about it. It's there, but we'd rather sweep it under the rug or save it for another place, because money. The house of God belongs to all who covenant to enter its doors. It's all of us. I was poring through older books I've collected in my time of ministry this past week, and one book I came across was a book that I actually had to purchase for a seminary class. It was about this thin. You see, most of my books were about this thick, you know, a couple hundred pages or more. This book was about this thin. It maybe has maybe 50 pages in it. And the title of the book is called Selling Swimsuits in the Arctic. Think about that for a minute. I'm going to give you three guesses, and the first two don't count, on what that book was about. It was about stewardship. Selling Swimsuits in the Arctic. It's a short book for its intent and purpose, which is to help us understand that stewardship in the life of the church is difficult to preach. Or, as the author better describes it, it's difficult as an idea to sell. Because, frankly, as a church member, as part of this covenant community, you, in a sense, have to buy into that idea, don't you? And really, who needs a swimsuit in the Arctic? The larger church has offered its best scripture for times of worship, and that usually sits within the Gospel of Matthew chapter 6. Where your treasure is, say it with me, there your heart will be also. Where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. Now, what's interesting is we usually stop right there when you talk about stewardship, because that's good enough. Where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. But what's really fascinating to me are the two verses that follow. You see, this whole chapter of Matthew is really all about stewardship. And we take out that one little slice in verse 21. But verse 22 and verse 23 really point the fingers at us. Take a listen to this. The eye is the lamp of the body. Therefore, if your eye is healthy, your whole body will be full of light. But if your eye is bad, your whole body will be full of darkness. If then the light in you is darkness, how terrible that darkness will be. This follows: where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. Ouch. The eye is the lamp of the body. What are the things that you look at, that you're focused on, that the takeaway from everything that is like, what are the things that you really, really want, that you strive for, that you think you need? Perhaps a refocusing is in order. I do believe that Western spirituality is beyond being on the cusp of a time of enlightenment. I believe we've fully entered into a time of enlightenment, a time where we reevaluate what church is, not just the capital C as the community, but the lowercase c. And of course, the pandemic has kind of shoved us full on into this idea of rethinking church. Who'd have ever thought in our lifetime that we would have had a full year of virtual worship service together? Wow. And that just didn't come as an idea, that came as a necessity. I believe that time is challenging the church as we know it to wrestle with the way things have always been, and to stretch ourselves into the way God is pointing us, the way things have to be in the here and now. Sure, the church could always make ends meet by doing what it has done in the past. The budget's tight. Let's cut the children's program, the youth programs. Let's cut our giving to OCWM, our church's wider mission. Let's cut this ministry and this ministry and to really save the church, let's cut the staff and still expect the same result. Rarely talked about is what lies deep within the heart, our covenant to a greater community. In the realization that we are a part of that covenant, we begin to understand that the sacrifices must not be made by others, but by ourselves. Those are the hardest ones. This covenant has been written deep in our hearts by God, calling us to find ways to, as the psalmist sings, fix our eyes on God's ways. Did you catch that? Fix our eyes, as the author of Matthew suggests, on things that give life and light. For where our treasure is, there our heart will be also. May God add blessing and the meaning to these words, now and forevermore. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen. Friends, as we take some time to enter into prayer, I do want to point all of you to Reverend Nadia Boltz Weber. You can find her through various social media platforms. But she writes so openly and honestly about where she is at the moment. And I find myself identifying with much of what she has to pray about. And so here we are. Spring has sprung. And I want to invite all of us as we enter into prayer to engage in this prayer as if God has sown seeds deep in our hearts and is nurturing them for us for the coming harvest. Spring is that season. Let us go to God in silent prayer. Gracious and loving Lord God, speak shalom into our hearts. Help us find the peace that is absence of lack, and help others find the same. Help us recognize these words on our heart as covenant commitment by you, gracious God, our Creator, for constant, unfailing love and support, for the blessings that have been bestowed upon us, for the ways in which you can empower us to spread those around. God, be with us as we stretch ourselves to find ways in which we can sacrifice, in which we can live into our covenant commitment in our community of faith and grow in spirit, and watch in turn your church, the capital C and the lowercase c, also grow with it. Gracious God, hold our hands and guide our footsteps as we traverse those fears which hold us back. As we turn away from those temptations that would take our attention elsewhere. And help our eyes refocus on shalom once again. In the name of Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Creator, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Our offering in what we give is very much an act of worship. It is a verb, something we do to grow the mission and ministry of Salem UCC. In so many ways, all of you have participated in the life of Salem, and it shows. And we give thanks and gratitude for your continued support and for your generosity in the days to come. Let us bless the gifts that have been given together. Would you pray with me? We dedicate these offerings to the proclamation of your word, the teaching of your ways, and the living of your will for all humankind. We reach out with joy and gladness to offer your love to the world. May these gifts enable the sharing of your presence with many who have not experienced a sense of their own value as your children. As we keep covenant with you, we would also share its joys and obligations with our neighbors. Amen.
To me that you are God. my heart, I give my life, I give my all to you. Christ, my teacher and healer, teach my heart and heal my soul.
Beloved, God has written the law of love within us. We are empowered to live according to that law.
We have experienced God's presence together. That presence will sustain us as we scatter.
God's wisdom has been planted in our hearts. It is different from the wisdom of this world's.
We dare to live as forgiven and forgiving sinners. We risk showing love to those who seem unlovable.
We are people of God, accepted and loved. We are followers of Christ, commissioned for service.
Where Christ leads, we will follow. Where our service is needed, we will go. Let us go forth into the world in peace. Be of good courage. Hold fast to that which is good. Render to no one evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted, support the weak, help the afflicted, honor all people. Love and serve the Lord, rejoicing in the presence of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
A new song to him.
Blessing of Jesus Christ. Thank you for joining us this morning. Amen. And,